Hello everyone, Vincent Teo from HDTV Test here. In this video, we're going to compare the picture quality of the Panasonic EZ1000 and the Sony A1 to OLEDs, which could potentially be the best TV to come out in 2017. Coming right up. At any moment, a courier will knock on my door and collect the Sony A1 review sample, so I'll still need to pack it up with the chap. But before doing that, I think it is probably best for me to take the opportunity while I have two of these fantastic televisions in this room today to do a comparison video in terms of the picture quality. So we have the Panasonic EZ1000, also marketed as the EZ1002 in the UK, here, and it is the 65-inch version. On the far end is the Sony A1 OLED, which is also 65-inch version. The A1 is marketed as the A1E, the Bravia A1E in the United States. So we have two of the top manufacturers in terms of picture quality. And the reason I say they are top in terms of picture quality is because these Japanese manufacturers, Panasonic and Sony, I've always respected their video processing. And I think the reason is because they have an arm in their company that actually deals with content creation. Panasonic has Panasonic Hollywood Labs, and Sony has Sony Pictures Entertainment. And these two facilities, post-production facilities, they have tons of video expertise. They have tons of post-production heritage and tradition. And that's why I always rate these two, Panasonic and Sony, as among the top in terms of color accuracy and video fidelity, precisely because of the reason I think because of their heritage and tradition in terms of content creation. They have a division in their companies, in their respective companies, that deal with making movies, post-production, and things like that. And this knowledge will certainly have been passed on to their engineers in terms of producing, manufacturing, and developing consumer televisions. And we can certainly see the results here, which is why I'm so excited to do this comparison today. First, let's talk about near black performance. Most video enthusiasts will know by now that due to OLED's self-emissive characteristic, they are capable of true 0CDM square blacks, which lend themselves to really rich colors and wide viewing angles. But getting the area between black and just above black has been more tricky for many of the previous OLED TVs because of the off state of black and also the on state where you have to pass a current through to generate these very, very dark grays. So in terms of the cleanliness and stability of the above black rendering, I think all the 2017 OLEDs perform very, very similarly. And that certainly applies to the Panasonic EZ1000 or EZ1002 and the Sony A1 or A1E as well. We played the now famous scene in Skyfall where Javier Bardem is walking up a hill towards the chapel. The night sky looked very, very similar on both of these displays. And this is regardless of whether smoke gradation was switched on or off. If we actually don't pause the scene, if we just sit at a normal viewing distance, and if we look at it, they both look very, very equal, and they are very, very watchable. Obviously, this is a very, very pristine source. If you pause the scene, I think we can probably see a bit more noise on the Panasonic, but once you start playing in real-life content from a normal viewing distance, then both of these, and including the LG 2017 OLEDs, like the C7 and the B7 as well, they present the near-black region in a much cleaner and stable manner than 2016 OLEDs or even 2015 one, which can be affected by noise, pixelation, posterization, macro blocking, fizziness in very, very dark scenes. The now very, very notorious ones being certain episodes in Game of Thrones, heavily compressed, bit starved, and you will just see the crawling noise in really, really dark scenes because of the compression that is used. But the Sony A1 and also the Panasonic EZ1002 certainly handled this much better, not only for pristine source like Skyfall, but also we watched some programs from Sky TV, from BBC, from ITV on these two sets. And from a normal viewing distance, regardless of whether smoke gradation was enabled or disabled on the Sony OLED, these two televisions presented these above black regions in a much cleaner and more stable manner. What will be slightly more different is that the Sony has a 2.2 gamma nearer to black, so it may look slightly washed out. But as a result, because what I think Sony engineers were trying to do is to minimize the gap between OLED's true 0CDM square blacks and the intra content just slightly elevated black level. So they minimize the gap so that it will present a cleaner, less noisy image. Whereas the Panasonic out of the box is already fairly close to 2.4 gamma out of the box in terms of the default value if you choose one of the more accurate modes, and it can be calibrated to a flat 2.4 as well, giving more depth to the picture, but also maybe creating slightly more noise. I don't think it is actually very visible from a normal viewing distance in terms of the noise, so I would say that it is probably a very, very tiny difference, a hairbreadth split difference, really. So I don't think anyone is significantly superior than the other. The Sony OLED will be slightly cleaner, especially with smooth gradation. If you have really bad posterization in certain scenes, then the smooth gradation will help. But the Panasonic can present a slightly richer image in the really, really dark regions. While we're on the subject of near black, all OLEDs will exhibit some sort of vertical streaks, what we call vertical streaks or banding on very, very dark scenes. And I haven't seen any OLED that I've tested, I've reviewed, I've calibrated out in the field that is actually entirely free of this problem. So I will go so far as to say that all OLED panels do have this problem. And if you don't see it, good for you. That means that, you know, you're not aware of this problem. But I would gladly accept this problem compared with some other problems that you see on other display technologies. No TV technology is perfect, but I would gladly take the OLED's true blacks, rich colors and wide viewing angles, and accept that there will be some banding or thin streaks. It varies from panel to panel. There's a bit of a panel lottery going on here, but I would gladly accept these small compromises. It's not as if the LED LCDs are free of backlight or screen uniformity issues. Off the top of my head, I can think of clouding, flash lighting, the dirty screen effect that affects LED LCDs as well. So it's not as if they are completely free of these effects, and they don't have as wide a viewing angle. And in terms of the blacks, they can't generate as deep a blacks. Obviously, the full array local dimming LED LCDs, they can switch off their backlight in certain zones when true black is required. But when you need to generate a picture, the backlight always needs to be on, and by having a backlight on, it actually just contaminates the colors slightly. Obviously, you know, you can correct it. What is good about OLED is that every pixel can be switched on and off independently of each other, so no backlight needs to be on. You can just generate color out of really nothingness. The true blacks really act as an ideal canvas for the colors to flourish and pop. Okay, moving on to the next bit, which is motion, right? All these OLED TVs are sample and hold displays. This includes the Panasonic EZ1000 and the Sony A1. Both of them are sample and hold displays. By sample and hold, what I mean is that when an image is generated on screen, the frame is held continuously until the next frame dictates a refresh. And this creates motion blur in our mind because, you know, the image sticks in our mind. Now, the alternative to sample and hold displays are impulse-based display. Impulse-based displays are probably CRT and plasmas. Now, on these technologies, on these televisions, the inherent decay of the organic phosphor just creates a fade to black interval, a very, very short interval, but it's there, a fade to black interval, which actually clears up our retinal persistence and make motion look sharper and clearer. One thing I need to say is that motion blur perception varies from individual to individual, and it depends on what technologies you are used to in the past. So if you are used to CRT and plasmas, I think if you make the jump to OLED, you will feel that it looks blurrier. Whereas if you are used to LED LCDs in the past, and LED LCDs are sample hold displays as well, if you are used to watching LED LCD, LCD-based displays or PC monitors, then I don't think you will find that the motion blur is significantly worse on these sets. In fact, it may actually be better because OLED pixel response time is near instantaneous. It is about 1,000 times faster than LCD-based displays, so you won't get any smearing or black trailing. I would say that the motion looks cleaner on an OLED than an LED LCD. But because of the sample and hold driving method, you will still perceive motion blur because the image is just sticking in your mind. Now, hello? Yes. Right? Now, the Panasonic EZ1000 or EZ1002 and the Sony A1 or A1E offers a couple of technologies to improve motion blurring. First is interpolation. What interpolation means is basically injecting artificial frames in between the original frames to reduce motion blur, but it can have a couple of side effects, mainly a soap opera effect to 24 frames per second movies, and also interpolation artifacts such as tearing, shimmering, or halloing artifacts that you see when ball is flying across the crowd. Because of the complexity of the scene, when you try to inject artificial frames, the algorithm gets confused, and so it may introduce this sort of artifacts. Now, the other method is black frame insertion. Black frame insertion means that black frames are injected in between the original video frames to try and mimic impulse-based display. Remember what I said about impulse-based display? Basically, the organic decay of the phosphors create a black interval which clears our retinal persistence. And that's what the black frame insertion technology is trying to do. It injects the black frame in between the original frames, mimicking an impulse-based driving method, and therefore making motion sharper and clearer. Now, there are two side effects normally associated with black frame insertion due to how it works. Because you're inserting black frames, the light output will generally drop, and also they may be flicker. The Panasonic EZ1000 and also the Sony A1, they have these two technologies. So they have actually the interpolation technology and also the black frame insertion mode. Now, to enable black frame insertion on the Panasonic EZ1000 or EZ1002, you need to go into the menu and switch clear motion to on. On the Sony A1 or A1E, to activate black frame insertion or BFI, you need to set clearness to high in the motion flow custom submenu. Now, in terms of the light output, I mentioned that black frame insertion has a couple of side effects, mainly a drop in light output and also flicker. Now, in terms of light output, I think even with black frame insertion engage on both sets, I think it is actually sufficient in all but the brightest rooms. If you crank up the luminance, you can generally hit around 185 nits on a 10% window, or 63 nits on a full field frame. And I don't think that full field frame is that important for watching movies because of the letterbox bars lowering the general APL or average picture level of the scene. So we are concerned with the 10% window, certainly on immersive displays anyway. So, and certainly I think with black frame insertion, it is going to be sufficient for all but the brightest rooms. Now, what will put more people off black frame insertion on these displays may be the flicker. If you feed a 60Hz video signal to these TVs from a PS4 or let's say from a game console or a PC to these TVs, even on a full widescreen, I personally don't see any flicker. Obviously, I will see some flicker if I stare really hard at the screen, but in real life photorealistic content, I don't really see that much of a flicker at all. Bearing in mind though, I have to warn you, flicker sensitivity varies from one person to another. There are some people who are extremely sensitive to flicker, which is why maybe they don't get on with plasmas and DLP projectors with their rainbow effect. And so maybe the 60Hz flicker will look very, very flickery to your eyes and you can't tolerate it. But certainly to me, the 60Hz flicker is eminently watchable. If we switch to a 50Hz video signal, such as the broadcast signal that we get in the UK and Europe, then there will be slightly more flicker than 60Hz. But the main difference between these two sets in terms of the black frame insertion is when you send a 24Hz signal to the television, the Panasonic will present it with less flicker than the Sony A1, which look extremely flickery when you send a 24Hz signal to the TV. I personally think this is not a big deal because I don't generally use black frame insertion with 24 frames per second movie anyway, because 24 frames per second movie or 24Hz content is meant to have some blur in it anyway to create this really dreamy, surreal filmic look that we like so much. So I don't generally switch on black frame insertion for 24Hz content anyway. But if you decide to switch it on, then the Sony will look much more flickery than the Panasonic. With that out of the way, let's talk in terms of motion resolution using the test pattern that we normally put on screen. It's basically a column consisting of four lines scrolling from right to left of the screen. with thick lines at the top and fine lines at the bottom. So this is the motion resolution test pattern from the FPD benchmark software testis that we have been using for a while now. The sample and hold baseline is 300 lines. So if you don't switch on true motion or intelligent frame creation on these TVs, then the motion resolution will come in at the normal sample and hold baseline of 300 lines. If you switch on interpolation or black frame insertion, it will more than double it to about 650 lines. For some reason, this is the maximum motion resolution that we can get from a WRGB-based OLED displays, you know, throughout the years. And one thing I will say is that these are two of the first 4K OLED that I've seen with black frame insertion, because previously LG OLED has never had black frame insertion. Even this year, they don't have black frame insertion. They are relying on pure interpolation to reduce motion blur. Okay, let's talk about ABL. Now, ABL is automatic brightness limiter, which is a circuitry that is implemented on emissive displays to prevent the components from overheating when the image gets very, very bright. Because what the ABL is trying to protect the TV from is that when you have a very, very bright image across the entire screen, then most of the pixels will need to be lit and will need to be illuminated. And this can overheat, cause some damage, damage some component or whatever. So ABL is a circuitry that has been implemented on emissive displays such as CRTs, plasmas, and now OLED. In terms of the ABL aggressiveness, by ABL aggressiveness, the more aggressive the ABL, the more it dims down the image when a bright screen is presented. And this year's OLEDs, the 2017 OLEDs, including the Panasonic EZ1000 and the Sony A1, and also the LG OLEDs, the 2017 OLEDs, they are much less aggressive in terms of the ABL versus last year's sets and the sets before. What this means is that a brighter scene will generally look brighter on 2017 sets versus 2016 sets. Now, the ABL aggressiveness on these two sets are roughly about equal. You can probably see it from this test pattern that was authored by my good friend and colleague David McKenzie. It consists of a small white circle that expands to fill up the entire screen. And if you see any difference in the video, it is entirely down to the camera. From where I'm sitting, it is roughly equal between the Panasonic EZ1000 and the Sony A1. If we play a snow mountain scene from planet Earth, the white look equally bright and pristine. Moving on, let's talk about video processing. Now, I've repeatedly claimed that the Sony A1 and the Sony XC93 and the Sony ZD9 have the best in TV upscaling that I've actually seen on a consumer television, and that still largely holds true. If we put up an SMPT RP133 test pattern in 576i, which is a resolution, a PAL resolution we get here in the UK and Europe, if we put it on both screens, the Sony is just rendering it slightly sharper with slightly less junk pixels. The difference is very, very slight, and from a normal viewing distance, I really can't see that much of a difference when I watch some content, let's say the Skyfall Blu-ray, on their faces in terms of the detailing and the sharpness. I think it's splitting hairs here. If I have to choose, the Sony is slightly sharper, but you know, the Panasonic is doing an extremely good job as well. Next, let's talk about HDR. I showed you this in previous videos before, but the Panasonic EZ1000 or 1002 and the Sony A1 or A1E use different tone mapping algorithm. So they are both very, very well optimized for 1000 nit graded HDR movies, such as The Martian, The Revenant, Kingsman, and so on and so forth. But it is on movies that are graded or mastered at 4000 nits that there's a substantial difference in terms of the tone mapping. These two displays are probably only capable of a maximum of 750 nits of peak brightness. But when you try and fit a 4000 nit content onto a 750 nit display, you have to choose between preserving highlight detail or preserving the overall brightness of the picture. And Sony has gone the way of preserving the brightness. So they will be discarding some detail between 1000 nits and 4000 nits. As you can see from the scenes from Batman vs. Superman, Dawn of Justice, and also from this movie called Pan, which is mastered to 4000 nits as well. The Panasonic will follow the EOTF curve, the electro-optical transfer function curve, as tightly as possible, and then roll off very, very nicely at the top end to preserve more detail between 1000 and 4000 nits. If you look at Batflex White Shirt, if you look at the Sun in Pan, the Panasonic will preserve them better than the Sony. And what impressed us about Panasonic's tone mapping algorithm is that I think it is probably still losing some detail at the top end up at 4000 nits. But what impressed us about Panasonic's algorithm is that they try to follow the EOTF curve, the PQ-EOTF, which is the perceptual quantization, electro-optical transfer function. It's a mouthful, I know, and I have trouble saying it all the time as well. So it's a mouthful, but it's PQ-EOTF is basically the standard that dictates how the luminance from the source signal should be presented on screen for HDR. And the Panasonic EZ1000 will follow it as tightly as possible and then gradually smooth it out at the top end, lower the brightness versus the reference to try and retain more detail. Now, usually this approach usually introduces some sort of posterization because the Samsung 2016 sets and the QLEDs use the same approach as well, and the Lever Build 7 use the same approach as well. Maybe more aggressively than this. So I think on those TVs, they are preserving all the way up to 4000 nits, whereas this Panasonic EZ1000, it goes up, maybe, you know, it's throwing away, let's say 3000, 3005. I don't know the exact figure, but, you know, if you compare side by side between this and the Samsung QLED or the Lever Build 7, I think, you know, they have more detail, but they will look significantly darker in the overall image. And also those TVs will be presenting some posterization. By posterization, I mean if you look at the sky in The Martian or in The Revenant, there will be distinct steps where it should be smooth. And this Panasonic EZ1000, I really, really like their tonal mapping algorithm. It's really, really smooth. I think, you know, it actually can compete with the Sony A1 without smooth gradation enabled on the A1. It's actually on par in terms of the smoothness. If we look at the sky in The Martian, it is very, very equal in terms of the smoothness and the lack of posterization. Before you start saying that Sony is doing something wrong and ask them to try and fix something, let me just stress that there is inherently nothing wrong with their approach anyway. When you're trying to tone map 4000 nits to 750 nits, you need to make a decision to sacrifice detail or sacrifice brightness. And Sony has decided to sacrifice detail and preserve the brightness. And there's inherently nothing wrong because there's no established standard for tone mapping anyway. Maybe Sony is just going to bank on Dolby Vision when the support comes on with a firmware upgrade later this year to correct this. And on that note, I need to actually stress that a very, very substantial difference between these two is that the Sony A1 will eventually be Dolby Vision capable with a firmware update, but the Panasonic EZ1000 or 1002 will never be Dolby Vision capable. And we've asked the engineers a lot of times, and they have said that they're not going to do Dolby Vision on this set. So if you are thinking about getting a Dolby Vision Blu-ray player or a Dolby Vision disc in the future, Dolby Vision is a proprietary system by Dolby that uses dynamic metadata for frame-by-frame or scene-by-scene optimization. And in theory, it sounds better, but we haven't actually had the chance to watch Dolby Vision content side-by-side against a HDR10 content. HDR10 is the open standard which the Panasonic EZ1000 use. So we haven't actually done any in-depth testing of Dolby Vision versus HDR10 on capable displays, certainly not on these OLEDs. But I'll be interested to certainly find out the difference between Dolby Vision and HDR10 when I get a chance to test it properly. Okay, another advantage of the Panasonic EZ1000 and two over the Sony A1 is the color accuracy. Now, Panasonic has always placed a lot of importance on colors, and certainly that continues with the Panasonic EZ1002 as well. So it has a 10-point white balance controls, 10-point gamma controls, and a 3-axis for 6 colors color management system or CMS, whereas the Sony, it only has a 2 and 10-point white balance system. And even then, the 10-point white balance system, from our testing here and there, it doesn't really interpolate as well in between the adjustment points. So, and it doesn't even have a CMS. No Sony TVs ever had an advanced color measurement system. Whereas the Panasonic EZ1000, as with most of the high-end Panasonic flagships since 2011, 2012, I think, they all have 2 and 10 point white balance controls, 10 point gamma controls, and an advanced color measurement system that allows us to adjust the hue, saturation, and luminance of the three primary colors of red, green, and blue, and the three secondary colors of cyan, magenta, and yellow. So very, very, very comprehensive. And if you own one of these Panasonic sets, it can really be calibrated to an inch of their life to reflect the color accuracy and fidelity that the filmmaker studios are trying to get across to you. So you will be experiencing movies and films or TV programs in the manner that is intended by the directors and the producers. I forgot to mention this when I was talking about video processing, but one of the unique selling point, one of the key features of the Sony A1 is the smooth gradation feature. Now, I think inherently, if you switch it off, the Sony A1 and the Panasonic EZ1000, they don't look, you know, a million miles away. I think, you know, they both present, you know, any real life content with equal amount of smoothness. But I think it is in animated films, such as a tonally flat background in an animated film, that smooth gradation can come in really useful. So I'm using this example here in the animated film from DreamWorks called How to Train Your Dragon. And there's a shot here with the sky in the background. You can see that with out smooth gradation turned on the Sony A1, there's some distinct steps. For some reason, these consumer televisions just find it hard to render animated flat tones in a smooth manner. So there will be some steps here and there. So you can see some posterization on the Panasonic OLED, and you can see some on the Sony OLED with smooth gradation turned off. But if you switch smooth gradation on, the steps just go away. This is an amazing technology, and I can't really find much downside to it. Obviously, by applying this sort of technology, there's a risk that you can actually destroy fine detail. You can mask fine detail. But if you keep it to the smooth gradation setting of low, I certainly, throughout all the content I've watched, I never found it to be of any detriment. So certainly, you can see from this How to Train Your Dragon here that smooth gradation worked well to smooth out posterization in animated films. Input lag is lower across the board on the Panasonic EZ1002. I think it's fantastic of the company to recognize the importance of input lag in TV purchase decisions, especially among gamers. And that applies to Sony as well. Both of them, I think most companies now are increasingly recognizing the importance of input lag. It's become a numbers game, but you know, the lower input lag, generally the more appealing display will be to a gamer. So the input lag on the Panasonic EZ1002 or EZ1000 is around 25 milliseconds, regardless of whether it's in SDR or HDR. But if you want 444 chroma, then the input lag will jump to around 36 milliseconds. On the Sony A1, it has different input lag depending on whether you send it a 1080p signal or a 4K signal. If you send it a 4K signal, the input lag will be around 31 milliseconds, regardless of whether the signal was in SDR or HDR. But if you send it a 1080p signal, the input lag will jump up by one frame to 47 milliseconds. And again, this is regardless of SDR or HDR. So try and send a 4K signal from your PS4 Pro or your Xbox One S to the Sony A1 to get 31 milliseconds. And 31 milliseconds is not a million miles away from the 25 milliseconds of the Panasonic EZ1000. Okay, I hope you found this video kind of useful. It was just me rambling away for about, I don't know how long it is, probably about 20-30 minutes, I don't know. So it was just me rambling away because I just wanted to take this opportunity to compare and explain the picture quality differences between the Panasonic EZ1000 or EZ1002 and the Sony A1 or A1E OLED, while I still have the chance of them side by side here in this room before I get I've actually already received a phone call from the courier saying that they'll be here in about 10 minutes time. So I'll need to wrap this up. In summary, these two are fantastic televisions, and they have cleaner above black handling than 2016 OLEDs. They have outstanding video processing. But what separates these two are, I think on the Sony A1, the key feature is smooth gradation, which can work really well to smooth out the banding or posterization. I say banding, but the technical term is posterization, to smooth out posterization in low bitrate content and especially monotone backgrounds in animated films. Smooth gradation is Sony's strength, whereas the strength of the Panasonic EZ1002 is color accuracy, especially after calibration. The color accuracy, because of the comprehensive array of calibration controls, the gamma, the white balance, and also the CMS. Another difference is in terms of HDR. The Sony A1 will support Dolby Vision, the Panasonic EZ1002 won't. And in terms of HDR10 movie presentation, for 4000 nit graded content, the Sony A1 will be throwing away or clipping some detail between 1000 nits and 4000 nits, whereas the Panasonic EZ1000 or EZ1002 will be trying to preserve them as much as possible, running all the way up to 4000 nits at the expense of lowering the brightness of the image slightly. Again, you know, before you start criticizing Sony for doing this, there's no standard in tone mapping. Is what manufacturers feel they need to do to try and tone map 4000 nit content to 750 nit displays. And when you do that, when you try and do that, you have to choose to either sacrifice detail or sacrifice brightness. But I really, really do like Panasonic's approach. They are trying to retain as much detail as possible, and the picture still doesn't look too dark. And there's no posterization, unlike what we have seen on the Samsung 2016 SUHD and the 2017 QLED. And also the Loverbill 7. Right, I think my time is up. If you've enjoyed this video, if you found this video useful, please click the like button and subscribe to the HDTV Test YouTube channel for more videos like this. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you the next time.